We need to go upstairs.
Okay.
No,
sure.
Last Friday, but we went to Cavite.
Saturday.
Yeah, we went to Cavite Saturday. We arrived here Saturday and Friday night.
Okay.
And then we went to Cavite. We spent a couple of days there. And then yesterday we came. Yeah, we came to Manila, and we had a little problem with the transportation, so we finally secured transportation for this morning last night. And we stopped about two or three places before we got here.
This morning?
Yeah.
So,
three places we stopped.
Really? Where were you by?
Oh, dito ako.
This is my boss, Nelson Lopez.
Mr. Lopez.
Yes, welcome.
Oh, thank you. And party, all right. And tourists from the Republic of Palau. Very nice.
Anyway, it would be great if you could have time to see other, aside from tilapia, marine farms. But the Dagupan farms that we have is about 3 to 4 hours, no, from here. So yeah, it's quite far.
Uh-huh.
So instead of Dagupan, we decided to have it a short, but an overnight trip to Visayan City, Buños, in Nueva Ecija. Because the National Center for Tilapia is stationed, is located in Nueva Ecija.
What we really want to see is how you hatch tilapia,
sure,
and how you come up with a hybrid, which is the color of the tilapia changed to red or some other color besides, you know, the original color. We want to know all the technical information as far as how to raise, how to farm, how to, you know, even the market, you know, if you will. And when we get that information, you know, we can talk to my colleagues, you know, and see if we can pass the law to allow farming for tilapia. With assistance from our ambassador, you know, he's been helping us on this project, and we really appreciate him, you know, of getting through, you know, with you people here in the Bureau of Agriculture. Yeah, and all your help you can give, you know, we appreciate
it. Sure.
Yeah. So if you don't mind, we're going to be filming this throughout the whole tour, and we're going to get these informations back and then show it to our people.
No problem.
No problem, yeah?
And we were, I don't know if, I was not sure if it was you or the Fisheries Department of Palau wishes to have a collaboration on the crab, the marine crab. I don't know if it's somebody from the department.
Yeah, it was through fisheries.
Yeah, I think we were collaborating. Yeah.
I've heard about it, but I was never part of it.
Before, yeah.
Yeah, before, you
know. That was about 2 years ago.
There's a pending legislation right now. Our laws now say that we're not allowed to keep less than 6 inches, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Less than 6 inches, you know, so anything less than 6 inches, you cannot have in your possession.
Catch. Yeah.
Yeah. And when we bring the crab from the Philippines, you know, it's the small one to farm or to raise them, you know, that's against the law.
It is also forbidden here.
Yeah.
Transporting or even bringing it out. But we can bring out breeders,
mm-hmm,
the matured one, for reproduction purposes.
Yeah. So we're working on, there's a legislation that has been introduced to amend the existing law,
mm-hmm,
to allow local farmers, you know, to keep them and raise them, you know, but right now they cannot. So when they find a small one, they let it go back to the wild.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if we keep the small one, you know, and try to raise them, right now we already find a way to, you know, we have a hatchery,
mm-hmm,
where we put, you know, a crab in there, and then they managed to hatch about over a million of crab, and then they let it go to about this size, you know, and release them to the wild.
Yeah, that's the natural dispersion.
And that's Palau Community College is working on that. We're able to hatch the milkfish, and also the grouper and clams. Okay, so now we're going to be working on tilapia. And if we can get the tilapia, you know, we're going to be okay. You know, we're going to be able to eat more tilapia and leave our reef fish, you know, kind of
preserve the
high
value fish.
Because we've been eating our, reef fish, you know, and
that's a good program.
Yeah, with everybody now going out there, spear gun, and also at night they go and use a flashlight to get the fish. So through our embassy here in Manila, our ambassador is assisting us on this project. Mm-hmm. So I'll be here for a week and get all the information I can get to bring back with me.
We have the same problem before, because some provinces and some legislators are also not against, but they are worried about the environmental, ecological impact of this tilapia. Yeah. But through science and technology, we were able to develop system to control, regulate, and even produce a good kind of variety of tilapia that is suited for, not invasive, no, but a good quality that could be produced even in fresh water, in brackish water, and even in saline environment. And then you can control. So there's no problem in reproduction. Before there were problems in reproduction because the population keeps on growing, but the size is still small. So, and then we make use of that to feed other, as trash fish, to feed other high value species. But now we will inform you of other technology that is best for farmers, small scale, medium scale to large scale.
So now I think what they're interested in is to come up with the legislation, and you did mention that you can extend some assistance in developing an appropriate legislation that would address all those concerns. So I think that would be a very useful assistance extended to the.
And we will provide you all those information.
We will review the schedule and then take a look at the activities if it, it's convenient and acceptable to you. And then this runs up to January 21, Tama.
Okay.
And then we'll have a courtesy call to the assistant director, and some of them maybe you have met in Palau during the. And then at about 10:30, James will accompany you to Nueva Ecija, to the Science City.
About 3 hours.
The ambassador will have to see, and then they will have to take some footage off.
Okay,
and then you'll arrive back to Manila tomorrow, about 2 o'clock or in the afternoon? Okay, and on Wednesday, you are scheduled for result Eastern. So have you contacted the ex-retired general? So we are expected to be there by 8:30, 9. We leave at there, we will join tomorrow. Are you going today, on Wednesday, in Teresa? Up to Los Baños. So from Teresa, you will drop by the place of Dr. Palma, and then you will take a look at Taal Lake. By the way, Senator, is this your first time to go around Metro Manila?
Well, I have been up to Batangas and Tagaytay.
Tagaytay?
Yeah.
You have seen the lake
I have
before.
Seen the volcano from up there.
And how about the cages?
No, I have not.
Okay. Yeah. That is your target destination, because right now they're farming tilapia cages in Taal, in some towns, coastal lakeshore villages.
That's on Thursday, right?
That's on Thursday in the morning.
Okay, and what we want to see really is how to hatch them.
Yeah, there are. You
how
can take
to maintain the hatchery.
Yes.
And how you feed them. from young all the way up to market size, and the design of farms. From a small scale to medium and also large scale. We want to get this information because first we want to feed ourselves. And then once you become expert of, you know, farming and produce tilapia, then we'll go into exportation. But
processing and then
we're talking about maybe export maybe about 5 to 10 years later.
Yes.
But right now we want we want to feed ourselves first. And then after that we'll think about the exportation of tilapia.
Okay.
And I think tilapia, why I'm after this, because I went to Nueva Vizcaya, and I was living in a hotel. That hotel is built right on the rice. What they did, you know, instead of rice, they took the rice out and make it a little bit deeper, put water in there,
farm,
and they farm tilapia. The restaurant is right on top of it.
You can see the
museum. You know what I want? When I want to eat the tilapia, they give me feed, and I just put them in the water and take a scoop net and scoop them.
You can select
and one. And then put them on top of the table about this size, and then I choose the one I like, and then I like this one, and then they, pick it, and then the rest of them, they just push them back in the water. And they swim away.
Yeah, still alive.
Yeah, so, you know, I mean, they're very easy to maintain.
Yes.
Yeah. And that's why we're here, to try to get the, we don't want to steal the technology. We want to ask you to share
the technology. We will transfer the technology. I will give you more information.
So every time when I eat tilapia, I think of you.
Okay, so
let's proceed.
Now, doctor, just a question.
Yes,
Ambassador. All your work, have you been able to identify parasites with tilapia and maybe some kind of disease that they may be carrying?
In the Philippines right now?
In the Philippines?
None whatsoever.
We want to know all the good things about them, and we want to know all the bad things about them.
Yeah.
Or if negative and positive, we want to know both, you know,
all
so aspects. We can decide. Like, if, lately they've been telling us that tilapia is invasive species, you know, which is, well, everything we have that were not part of Palau, that were brought in, like pigs, you know, papayas and stuff like that, that were also invasive before, but now they're part of the country. So I think the tilapia will be manageable, you know, by, you know, if we give us all the list things that we have to look for as far as environment, the negative environment impact, you know, like for example, you know, the tilapia will eat other fish or will eat certain plants in the water, or there the waste of raising tilapia will ruin other things. You know, we want to know those bad things about tilapia, if there is.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
All right.
So for, this is the major issues in concern now. One that is pressing us right now is the trading agreement, the trade order globalized. And then number two is the climate change that is affecting the country right now at present. We have right now an agreement with other countries, ASEAN countries, on Coral Triangle Initiative.
Would Palau operate with the...
I think Palau is included in this program. Right, Ambassador? Were you consulted on this?
Well, maybe not specifically included, but since Palau is quite near, we're just wondering if there could be some cooperation.
Because of the triangle, I know that Palau is one of the frequently visited and mostly by tourists to do diving in coral reefs.
You can just put that line to make it more triangular.
It could be. Yeah, it could be. We, when the director entertains us, please ask the director why Palau was not included, or we can make an maybe a good geographic.
Good triangle.
Just move the line up a little bit, you know.
Yes. And here are the species, the high-value species I mentioned, which are our target. the farm species to be cultured in those mariculture park. And I know that Palau is a rich country with all those species all around. But some of my friends were telling me that some of these species are already overexploited in Palau because of tourists, visitors, and other. That's why regulations is really very important. Because someday, who knows, you'll be importing seedlings from you. You fish the beast, a hatchery in Palau.
Yeah, there's one that's very common in the market that being sold live.
Our bangus, milkfish. We came here and we recruit a person from here, that expert of farming milkfish. Mm-hmm. So he came, and you know what? Today we took the milkfish and put them, in the open ocean.
Mm-hmm. Cage.
In the cage.
Yeah.
And they are very successful in they raise them up to these long, and then sell them to the longliners, mm-hmm. fishermen, and then they also separate the ones that they could let it grow about this size, for the market. When they get too big, they don't want them. So about this size will be the best one for the market. And a lot of Filipinos living in Palau are buying these bangus, because they're for some reason they taste much, much better than the ones that you have in the fresh water.
It tastes
different.
The marine one is better.
Yeah. It doesn't have that muddy taste.
Yes.
And
we have one commercial hatcheries, which is not being privatized scheme that we do. Investment from the government, and then we have it privatized by a commercial hatchery.
Oh, I see. And then when it's all in full operation, you'll bid it out, and then the private company come in and take over.
Even before the, there are already interested private operators who wants to operate that.
The previous, I see Tawi-Tawi. Are those Tawi-Tawi, the bigger?
Yes, we have.
Tawi-Tawi is probably about the size of Palau, but probably more people.
Which is more populated, Ambassador? Tawi-Tawi or Bungao? Bungao or Palau?
No, Palau only 20,000.
Oh, really? Oh, and then Tawi-Tawi, Bungao has also adjacent islands. So we have programs in fingerling dispersal out of the hatchery produced, mostly tilapia and carps.
I got a question.
Yes.
Way back, I've heard that a dynamite fisherman.
Yes.
It was really bad before. How is it now? Is the law kind of more working on these guys so they don't use chlorine?
Cyanide,
and all of that stuff. How is it now? Is it declining or?
It has been our integrated coastal resource management program with the cooperation of the mayors, governors, and congressmen has been so effective in cutting off these illegal activities. Mm-hmm. They formed themselves into a it's not a cooperative, but an association of fisher folk. They themselves in the community established a regulatory body, an apprehension. I think we trained them to apprehend, right? And these people are before the dynamite fishers, the cyanide operators.
We have them in Palau. Sad to say, but Filipinos in Palau are not allowed to go fishing by themselves.
Mm.
Because we found out that they take the small fish and the seaweed, anything in there to eat. So I said, okay, now we're going to assist you when you go there, so make sure you don't catch the small fish, or take the seaweed, because if you take the seaweed, there's nothing left for the fish to feed, so it's manageable. But local people, not Filipinos, but Palawans, they use dynamite from time to time, and the law is going after them. So it's getting better, but what I saw the other day when we, matter of fact, Sunday when we were coming,
right.
From Cavite, a polluted water, you know, where it would just dump trash and trash into your water. Don't you think that's kind of affect the, you know, the fishing industry in the Philippines?
It is, yeah.
It is?
It is our problem right now, environmental.
I see. Yeah. And that we don't have in Palau. We're very strict on that.
Oh, yes.
They are fined $50 just to throw in cigarettes on the ground. They're fined $50.
They have to be penalized.
So our country is very clean. Very clean. And we it's our policy, like when you see a trash, it belongs to you. So you pick it up. You know? So our streets are well clean, and also water. The boat operators, when they drive, you know, their boats and see a trash, they stop and pick it up and put it in their boat.
On initiative.
Yeah. That's, you know, and it's our program is going really.
That's one thing we have to learn from you, from Palau. Yeah.
But Philippines have done so much, you know, like Rojas Boulevard, you know, right there where it used to be, you know, those guys living down there and all kinds of trash, you know. Compared to 10 years ago, Philippines have done so much, you know.
They're not actually the same people who live in the coastal, but we have problems on flooding control. Because some of the waste are coming from within the urban areas, which is dumped to the canals and then goes out to the bay areas.
Yeah.
So most of the water control systems during flood seasons, especially during rainy seasons, normally gathers tons of debris and waste from the inland urban cities, districts.
Yeah.
And this goes out to the seas. And that's the time the bay areas are polluted.
Yeah, we are very close to Philippines, Indonesia, and Malaysia,
yeah,
and all
yeah.
these countries. You know, so, countries. Yeah, so, yeah. So we see, you know, like even this fishermen, you know, big fishing boat out there, they throw their trash right in the open ocean. And our shores right now are being polluted by debris coming from different countries, you know, nearby. And that's something we have to work on. So what we do, you know, we organize young school children during the school break, and they go out there, spend all day picking up trash and separate trash, you know, like the cans and the bottles and plastic, you know, and then dispose them, you know. So we have a very good program.
And we have passed agreement with the Department of Natural Resources, Environment, the local government unit, and then the Department of Agriculture about an information drive and even a code on how they would preserve and educate local folks, not only fishermen, on the environmental impact that is affecting the production.
And I went to fish department where they sell fish and seaweed and stuff like that, you know, and I saw milkfish about this big.
Yeah,
and it's a product of Philippines, you know. Yeah, and tilapia is a product of Taiwan.
Taiwan.
And they're fresh. So I don't know how they fly them in, or they're not frozen, they're fresh.
Yeah.
Fresh, you know. So, again, we want to get into tilapia because it's less expensive to raise and maintain. And first we want to feed ourselves, and then after that we want to export if possible. Question on the sea urchin. Do you farm those?
We have regions who are engaged in farming.
Oh yeah?
Sea urchin. But normally...
We're going to come back again to...
No problem. We are breeding sea urchin already.
Because Japanese, they really love to eat
I know.
Sea urchin.
But they are also 2 months in exploitation, also Chinese, because they have to gather the gonads.
Doctor, on your pangasius, I didn't see it's highly... First, but I see a lot of basa packed in the market.
In the Philippines?
Yeah.
Okay. The truth of it is almost 60-70% are not from the Philippines. It's an import from Vietnam.
About mainland China?
Oh, we cannot. But mainland China is also dumping a Zitro product.
Yeah. Doctor, thank you so much.
Okay, I think that's all. So, again, we welcome the party of Senator Duzan and Ambassador, and then we are going to see the director. James, please join me.
Yeah, yeah.
if you have any questions, because I have not discussed so much about tilapia, we will reserve this while you are on the way to Munoz, because it is our science city and our tilapia center for the Philippines.
We are number two in the production of tilapia in the world, next only to China. So Munoz would be a good place. In fact, some people consider Munoz a center for excellence, center for tilapia, center of excellence. So we have developed several strains of tilapia in Munoz. The latest is the GAP, the genetically enhanced tilapia, 30% better than the other strains.
Yes.
So
the color is much better.
Quality.
When you say number two, then China is number one. China, Republic of China, Taiwan?
No.
Mainland China.
China.
I see. Well, what I have seen in the market is, including Palau, our tilapia in the market are from Taiwan.
Taiwan?
Yeah, from Taiwan.
But China
is the number one. Yeah.
Because Taiwan, sir, is now supplying Guam and then the U.S. market.
Right,
mostly.
Right.
Well, we are number two, Senator, in the world. It's ironic that we're not really in the major list of major countries exporting tilapia fillet. We're not in that list because practically all of our production are consumed here in the Philippines.
So you consume more than export.
And for the growers,
they don't want to make the tilapia grow more because there's already a ready market when it reaches 250 or 300 grams. They can already make money because there's a ready market. But we are really aiming to export tilapia fillet to the U.S. because it's a
demand.
Market. Demand is growing for tilapia fillet. But we have to find a place in the Philippines where the people are not very fond of eating tilapia. And maybe you would allow it to grow into palatable size. Maybe down south in Mindanao. Because most of our tilapia production happens here in Luzon. In fact, there's only one region that is really dominantly the producer of tilapia. That is Region 3, where you are going now.
Yeah.
60% of our national production comes from that area. And that is an area surrounded by consumer centers, very fond of eating tilapia.
Senator, sir, has been. He was able to observe the hotel, which is serving a tilapia farm from behind the.
What they did, you know, there's about three rice fields. Yeah, and they took the dirt out and built a restaurant on top of it. Yeah.
Okay.
And it is very nice.
Tilapia is very fresh.
Very
right
fresh.
From the pot.
That's right. You just get it from down there and prepare it, you know. It's really good. Sir, we thank you so much for allowing us to come on this fact-finding mission for tilapia. In the committee, I introduced the bill to allow tilapia farming in Palau, because as of today, it's illegal to have them in Palau. Yeah. Well, there's some smart people that were living in Palau or still in Palau, and they declare that the tilapia is an invasive species, and therefore we don't allow them in country. And there's a little history of that, that you know, they found out that some fishermen from China and Filipinos put some of this tilapia in a tank, you know, in a tank somewhere in the woods, you know, and
they became so big, and what they did, the government went in there and put poison and tried to kill them and get rid of them. They said, and here's what they said. They said that this tilapia, once they go into fresh water, I mean the salt water, they'll eat all the fish in the salt water, they'll eat all kinds of seaweeds, you know, and that's why I'm here to prove them wrong. Yeah, okay. To prove them wrong. And I did some research and found out that tilapia are also in Lake Victoria, the biggest lake in the world in Africa. And this fish originated from Africa.
Yes.
Yeah, and it's also feeding a lot of people in South America and also Philippines and Indonesia.
Senator, the same controversy occurred here.
Yeah.
During the 50s, when tilapia was first introduced, there was a lot of uproar saying it would be an invasive species and it would kill off all our native species. And there was this great controversy, but then again, the tilapia, the people who wanted to introduce tilapia prevailed. And we find it a good thing because it's one of our mainstays in aquaculture.
Yeah.
Very easy to grow, very prolific, and it did not kill off the other species.
I'm doing this because a lot of our local fish, you know, the reef fish, they're reducing in numbers because more technology, faster boats, gill nets, than spear fishing, you know. So it's declining so fast. Plus the El Nino and global warming, you know. So what I'm trying to do is to come to Philippines and get the truth as far as how to farm tilapia to subsidize the consumption of fish. So instead of eating reef fish 100%, we can subsidize that by, you know, bringing in tilapia. And when we bring in tilapia, we're going to rely on tilapia more. And I think when we do that, you know, we will be less people out there catching fish in the wild, you know. And once we're able to feed ourselves, then we can think about exportation of tilapia.
We are also using aquaculture as an adaptation measure against climate change. So because we believe that climate change would really affect the wild in marine waters. And one of our adaptation measures is promoting aquaculture. And one of these species would be tilapia. To ease the pressure, twofold really, to ease the pressure from our seas and at the same time to act as an adaptation measure against climate change.
Right. And not only that, sir, but figure out if we allow this, a family can afford to have their backyards, have a pond, you know, and put tilapia there when the water is rough, when the weather is bad, they just go to the back and get it fresh. Yeah. So, and I think it's good idea to clear all these allocations saying that these are invasive species. Once that is out, then we come up with the legislation to allow farming, and I think that will be beneficial to the whole country and the people.
We would be happy to share our technology whenever Palau would require it. We would very much be willing.
The Philippines not only helping us on this issue, but also other things that the main workforce in Palau are 5,000 to 6,000 Filipino workers. And they also eat tilapia, and bringing in from Taiwan is very expensive for them to buy. So if we start producing our own, you know, they'll be less expensive, and our local Filipino workers will be able to feed themselves from this farming. Yeah,
a lot of other areas for cooperation between Philippines and Palau. And we look forward to closer coordination, collaboration with Palau, especially in fisheries.
Our meal fish project is very successful.
They're already breeding, sir.
Okay. And that came from Philippines. We came here, asked for the same, you know, help, technical, you know, help from the Philippine government, and even today we have those technical people still in Palau working with us, and our milk fish project is working really well, and we appreciate that. And now we're asking you again for tilapia technical information so we can start our own.
Sir, another thing, I remember, attorney, the coral triangle, geographic, the program.
Yeah.
They requested, sir, if we can make some...
Just move the line.
Yeah. Instead of the triangle.
We recently made a move to have Brunei included. Mm. And I think that's being studied now. We can always sponsor the move to Palau included for the Coral Triangle. Yeah, because it should really cover Palau. Solomons and Papua New Guinea are already there.
To make a perfect triangle.
Make a perfect triangle.
Yes, because
the drawing curves like that.
Yeah.
But if you include Palau, that goes in straight
to me.
So far, there are so many donors, so many lending institutions, and willing to give assistance to Coral Triangle initiatives. Okay.
Well, thank you.
We are also expecting another group from Palau, actually from PNA, maybe early next month.
Tuna group.
We will be extending our invitation for them to come for consultation.
Sir, I have to apologize to you and your office that there were supposed to be more than me, an ambassador, but this young country, we were only about 16-year-old country when we became independent, and we were running around trying to get all technical informations we need to develop our country. There were supposed to be 5 of us, but due to the fact that there's other applications in South Vietnam, which is involve our ambassador, those people that are going to Vietnam were not able to come with me on this mission. Yeah, so I apologize. We gave you a long list, but when I showed up, it was only me. And
you were able to come.
Yes, sir. And also I own a radio station and a television station. So what we do, we're going to take the entire, and then we're going to bring it back, and we're going to make a training film out of it.
Send it through with the golden voice.
Yeah, and we're going to educate our people as far as how to farm tilapia.
We will always welcome visitors from Palau to broaden their knowledge about not only the Philippines but on aquaculture, and we would be very much willing to share whatever technology we have.
Sure. So by requesting this tour with your office, we went through the office of your ambassador there, and at the same time we informed our embassy here, so with their help we were able to meet with you and get all the information that we
need. Ramon and I have been friends a long time ago.
Okay. Thank you again so much.
Senator,
all right, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay, let's move out. Down, up,
that way. Equals four. Four plus four equals eight. Don't begin and eat tayo magochocho. Ochocho. Ochocho. Ochocho na magochocho. Don't mind, we would like to ask your permission to film the whole presentation. And all the technical informations that we can put on our national television.
Yes,
is the whole country can watch and become more familiar with the tilapia. Yeah, because right now they're not allowed in Palau.
Oh, not allowed in Palau.
Yeah, we feel like, you know, it's invasive species, so but we don't have enough information on them. That's why you came here to ask for your expertise.
That's right. Yeah.
Okay, is that okay? All right. Thank you, sir.
This is the first from Palau. I would first mention your name
from our the ambassador of Palau. Mr. Ramon Retsibay, he's a non-resident ambassador to the Republic of Indonesia, at the same time as an ambassador to the Socialist Republic of Vietnam. So he's based in the Embassy of the Republic of Palau, here in the Philippines, in Manila. And we have our, on my right, from here side, is the chairman, Mr. Alfonso N. Diaz, of the Senate. Old Bill at Era Kelalu.
Yeah, that's Palau Congress.
So we'll give you just a briefing of our center. And so just a history, just a brief history. In 1979, we had the FFDP. I think fisheries is one of the models that bring forth peaceful existence in Region 3. So with the different strains that were brought during the GIP project, during the GIP genetic improvement of farm tilapia project, we had to continue further using the GET XL. GET is a GIP derived or GIP enhanced tilapia. And the XL, there's a meaning of XL, it's an excellent tilapia for livelihood enterprises. So there's a meaning of that GET XL. So with this, we were able now to enhance further our production from 80,000 metric tons in the 80s. Now we are reaching the 250,000 metric tons now, or even higher this last year. Maybe we already passed the 250,000 metric tons of tilapia.
These are the Kenya strain. We have because the GIP strain.
Oh,
we have during the GIP project, we have four different strains from Africa.
I see.
And then we have also four strains from Philippines. Four Philippines, Israel, Israel, Singapore, Thailand, and Taiwan. These are the domesticated strains.
I see.
And then these four African strains, they were part of the GIP program. So we got it from Egypt, from Senegal, Ghana, and Kenya.
So have you identified the one that is can grow in less time?
Yes.
And also can multiply in less time? Because that's the one that is more profitable, you know, because it's less time to grow it.
And then more fingerlings.
Right, right. So have you identified that?
That's right.
So can we have the name for that?
GET XL, improved GET XL. Jude is the one, the group of Jude, they are able to come up with a improved version. So as the genetic project was going, we were able to disseminate in 1995 this GIP strain to Bangladesh, to Indonesia, China, Vietnam, PNG, Fiji, and the rest of the ASEAN countries.
Yeah, yeah.
And they showed a very good performance in their respective countries. Even India, before they don't want the tilapia to enter their country.
Yeah.
Now it's already in the Indian in the country, and of course they perform better than their existing tilapias now.
How many days from fingerlings to a market size?
Marketable from size 17, they can already have the harvested informants.
Okay, we let's say that if the law pass, so yeah. we can start yes, farming.
Yeah.
Can we buy?
Here?
Yeah, from here.
Through our
your office,
foreign affairs and office, yeah. yeah, they can arrange already.
They can arrange for us to purchase yeah. from you.
Yeah.
Okay. How about the feed? Do
feed,
we?
Yeah, we have.
Feeds, you also have
yeah,
feed.
We have a team of what you call this nutrition.
Is that the same feed you when they're still fingerlings? You know, and the same feed you feed them until they grow up to. About this big, you still fit with the same thing, or
yeah, there are we call it this from primus, yeah. then it become a grower, then to juvenile, then juvenile to birth.
So you have a different feed for them?
Different size, but the same composition.
And then from here to Palau is only 2 hours.
Two hours.
Yeah, when we come from Palau, we only when we take off about an hour, and you ride on Davao.
Yeah.
Davao is closer to us than it is to Manila. Yeah.
So we have to bring here to Davao, then Davao to Palau. Or you, does it
take? We can come and get it straight from here. We just, yeah, we can just ship them through FedEx. You know how we got the tilapia into our waters. I mean, yeah. to a pond in Palau. There were some Filipino fishermen that mm-hmm. They carry this tilapia in their boats.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, when they're out there, you know, fishing, they carry those tilapia. I don't know for maybe bait or what. I don't know, but they brought them over, and they, for some reason, they got to know a local Filipino start working in Palau, mm-hmm. and they took some and put them in the tank. You know, big tank in the jungle, you know.
Okay.
And then when we got the word that the tank is full of tilapia, when we're there, they're big. Ooh. I mean, they're big. And everybody was so afraid to touch them. They said that those fish are no good. They came up with some wild, you know, mm-hmm. rumors. And so they went out there and put poison and tried to kill them. But for some reason, they didn't die.
Mm-hmm.
So most of them died, but about a year later, they came right back up. And they said that tilapia go down there and hide under the water or something like that, you know. But they don't die easily.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So now we still have some in there, and the government is going after them because this one guy said that they're invasive species, you know. So here we are, you know, trying to get more information as far as to how to culture them and substitute that with the, you know. The fish, the local fish, you know, because, you know, more people are eating fish, you know, and if you're going to keep getting from the reef, you know, it is no more. Yeah, yeah. So we rather switch to Palau.
The fish
yeah.
and the pit already.
Yeah. Yeah. And our ambassador is also interested in another fish. Mm-hmm. Maybe when we finish with tilapia, yeah, we're going to move right into, mm-hmm. he said that they
oh, pangasius.
Yeah. He's interested in it. He tells me that that one is better than tilapia.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so.
But the market now in the whole in USA, tilapia is still number one in terms of taste of the tilapia.
Why is it necessary to reverse the sex?
Okay, Jude, you can answer, Jude.
If the fish eat this much, then the food will convert into gonads. Instead
of being like that, so it's better if they are all male. So the farmer will produce more, the husband will be higher, if you have an old population.
Yeah. If there will be some questions about technology, my staff will be there.
I'm thinking about a small scale farming,
okay.
Not commercial type. I'm looking at this brochure here, and it says, Tank method. I'm more interested in that because, you know, Palau is not as big as Philippines. You know, they, I'd rather have each family that have a small piece of land in the backyard, you know, where they can build, use 6-inch block, you know, to make a tank as high as this and put water in it. I want to know if that will be possible and, you know, put water or make a tank as big as this building here and put water in it. Then I want to know how deep the water is, how you set it up, you know, you have a drainage on that,
yes,
you know, and that is affordable for a small family, like get a loan of maybe $5,000, $10,000 and do the concrete tank, put the fish in there, and then the feed will be available in local stores where we can just go and buy the feed and feed them, you know. And there also there will be somebody selling the fingerlings, you know, to stock, you know. So we stock them for 6 months, you know. We feed them for 6 months and sell them, and then go buy more and put them in there, and then raise them like you raise pig in the backyard, you know. And at the same time, they can, you know, harvest for consumption, for family consumption, you know, and they can sell, because we have about 5,000 to 6,000 Filipinos working in Palau. Yeah, and they rather have small one like this, you know, but the ones coming from Taiwan is about this big. They're very big, you know, and it used to be like 95 cents a pound, and now the dollar 95 cents a pound. They went up 100% increase, you know. So if we can, you know, grow tilapia locally, we can feed the Filipinos community, and also Palawans start eating tilapia. Yes.
That's good.
And we like them, you know. We didn't like them because they're freshwater fish, you know. Ah, yeah, we don't like that, you know. But when we tasted them, they're really good. They're really good. Especially when you open, split them in half like this and open them up, and you put like a mix of soy sauce and salt and some seasonings in there, you know, and you barbecue it. It's really good. Really good, yeah.
Okay, and we have 100 recipes of tilapia also now developed in the Philippines. 100
what do you call
it? Way to
cook. Yeah, recipe. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, for us, barbecuing is the best. Yeah. Because, you know, I mean, you put them on the fire and you sit around drinking beer, San Miguel, and talk, and then you just flip them, you know. So it's very easy to cook, you know. And yeah, if you can come up with like a brochure with some kind of a blueprint of how you build one, you know, or just, you know, some information as far how deep the tank gonna be, how big the size of the tank, you know, how deep the water should be, you know, and if there's a drainage, how do you, yeah, something like that. Can you teach us that?
Yeah, yes. We have a prototype at the back of our house.
Yeah, okay.
We can bring you there. But the being cultured as the heat of the catfish.
Yeah.
So it's convertible.
And our television crew there will film the way it's designed.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
But how much is the energy? Because we need to have some aeration and some water supply. How is it because of your electrical energy?
Well, if we can, I don't know, because this tank that I saw doesn't have anything. It's just a tank full of water. And this tilapia stays in there, you know, there's
no aeration, just water.
Just
Water.
When the rain comes, it goes in there, and when there's no rain, there's and they stay in there.
Yeah,
yeah. And they don't die.
You
but
can see our one in the back there. It's like this diameter. And,
but you have oxygen going in there.
Yeah, we have some. But the catfish is very resistant to that oxygen, so there's no oxygen there. But we have a line of water and oxygen.
Because what I saw in Guam, when, you know, in the market, it's open market. What they do on Saturday and Sunday, the parking lot, you turn to an open market, you know. Mm-hmm. And these Filipinos, they bring a big basin like this, about this much water, full of tilapia. And they stay there all day. They don't die.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they just swim, you know. And there's no oxygen, and water is very small, but they stay there.
Yeah,
as long as they're wet, they're okay. You know, so I figured out, like, this tilapia doesn't need any oxygen or just feed them and they'll be okay.
Yeah, there's a sucking density for particular cubic meters of water, so that it doesn't need oxygen. Just water will be present in case there is a fouling of your water.
But for a small tank like this, don't put 2,000 tilapia in there because it's not big enough, right?
We were able to design one of, in our backyard, this tank. with the halo blocks and then the water. You can see it when you go
up
around.
There.
Yeah.
I want to see it, and now I want to be the first one to build my experiment tank, you know. And then once the law passed, I'm going to be here to bring enough to bring back, and then see if I can raise
so
no, of course, not tilapia.
Carp, it's carp.
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 Yeah. Gross part also.
They don't die?
Common carp and koi carp.
Yeah, it's a fresh water fish also. It grows faster than tilapia.
But no, there are bones.
Yeah. It is a body fish. It's like meat fish with the intermuscular bones. It's cheaper than tilapia. It costs 40 to 50 pesos per kilo here in the market.
But more meat?
Well, tilapia is more costly here, 85 to 90 pesos per kilo.
Yes, this is tilapia.
That's tilapia, right there.
Ah. 25 centavos. It is size 22. This one is 25. Size 14, 45 centavos.
So, if we want to take this to Palau, we can buy them at this size?
Yeah, you can buy this size, the more you can put in the plastic bag.
In the plastic bag?
Yeah.
And how about the feed? How do we feed them?
No feeding while before you travel it. It will be conditioned for one day here.
Ah.
And pack in the plastic bag like that.
Uh-huh.
And you will time your flight. Uh-huh. So that it will not be delayed in the container. So it must be synchronized. So that it will arrive at Palau very safe and alive.
So when you get to Palau, then you immediately put in the big tank?
Just acclimatize it first. Don't release it like rice. You just put the
plastic
bag
in the water, in
on top of the water. Of
climatizing it now is, I don't understand. Tell me step by step how you
climatize. Yeah, that is in the brochure also.
In the brochure.
Yeah.
Okay. So water here is kind of, you know, it's temperature is little bit cooler than the water in Palau.
Yeah, like now. It's very cool here.
Yeah, it's cool, yeah.
But,
yeah.
I don't know, your climate there, maybe
it's
warm.
It's
warm, much warmer than here.
Yeah, but using the thermometer, we can check the temperature. Very plastic, and then to the way to be where you're
going. So if the temperature of the plastic, you have to get the water same temperature as the plastic temperature,
And
then that's
acclimatization.
I see.
For addition.
And also there is a process. Before you release that pieces on the container to the pan, you will open this after 10 to 15 minutes.
Oh.
Open. When you will just acclimatize by putting the plastic bag on top of the pan, then you open it, remove the rubber band, then slowly allow water to enter, water from the pan. Slowly.
Or from the tank maybe.
Yeah. From the tank or from the pan, the water will enter slowly. When the fish is already acclimatized, then they will come out one by one. No need to abruptly pour it in the pan. It will die.
Now we already thinking. We have to bring you. You gotta bring the fish over.
Yeah. I can do it.
Okay. You're gonna have to come, you know, with the fish. And you're the one who climatize it and then transfer, you know?
No problem.
Yeah, okay.
One year ago, This water here
actually comes from the ground. Here. And then what?
Let me ask one more question. Now that water is coming out of there, discharged from the bay, right?
And then goes down here and go back to the pond.
Go back.
It can go back to the reservoir.
They don't go there.
They don't go
they
there.
They go, they swim
against
the current.
You don't have to put a screen in there, right?
When there is small
you put a screen.
Yeah, sometimes
Okay.
But these fishes goes against the current.
Unlike, so this is how many feet is this tank here?
But you design this time?
It's 1.25. 1 meter and 25 centimeters.
Okay, like this. This is 6-inch blocks. Or yes, it's the straight concrete?
Concrete. No. Straight concrete. Oh, concrete pouring.
Oh.
But,
with bars in between?
Yes.
To hold it strong, yeah? Because a lot of water in here can break it apart.
But we can use concrete hollow block.
So I think if you use hollow block, cheaper. You know, it's cheaper and, yeah.
Easy to stop.
Yeah, yeah. And then that goes to the pond, and then you pump it again and put it here?
No. Separate.
Separate?
This is the water that goes here from the underground.
The well?
Right.
So in Palau we don't have wells, so can we get it from the river?
Yes.
We get it from the river. So in other words, we can build this next to a river.
Mm-hmm.
So we get the water from the river into the this. Yeah?
By
gravity flow.
Yes.
And then the drainage. And then go out to the river again.
Okay.
Ah, I see, I see.
So by the way, the water in the river is not polluted.
No pollution.
No pollution.
We are all Catholic, no pollution.
Oh, I see. Ask the senator why.
So this fish in there now,
okay, so
swimming in the same temperature as this water here.
Yeah, I see.
Slowly allowing
the water to pump in.
Yeah, and then
the fish will go on their own.
Oh. Because that drastic change in temperature can matai.
Yes!
Felicitated!
Yes, that will make the fish stress.
Oh, yeah, I see, I see. Okay.
And then sometimes, yeah.
Suffer high blood.
High blood.
Okay.
You put the rock to hold the mud,
yes,
so they don't go in, yeah?
Yeah.
How many thousand tilapia in there?
They are giving their feeders here for conditioning only. Broodstock pan.
Yes.
3 pieces per square meter, 3 pieces like that. For conditioning of breeders.
I see.
And also this is the screen. When you drain it, slowly removing this mud.
Ah.
And you put the screen here so that the quiz will not come.
Why,
out.
You drain this water out?
Yeah, we need to condition the pan.
Regularly.
Oh.
It will make
this. This is much bigger.
Much bigger pan.
Yeah.
And also you have a tilapia in there?
Yeah, we have stock breeders also here for fingerling production.
4,500 square meters. This one.
This is almost
but how,
a half hectare.
How do you count? Like, how do you count how many fingerlings in one bed?
We are having the sampling method first, then we weigh it and get the average weight of the fingerlings. When you get the sample, you count it and you divide the weight from the number of grams. So when the average weight is 1 gram, 1 kilogram contains 1,000 pieces.
1,000 pieces,
yeah.
Okay. So you sell to the farmers and then they take them out to their
farms.
And then... Okay.
And we render that...
Acclimatize it and put them in the pond.
Yes.
And then start feeding, eh?
Yeah.
For 6 months out to the market.
Sometimes when you get it here, it's already bigger like that sizes we have shown you.
Uh-huh.
You can harvest it 3.5 to 4 months.
Okay.
It depends on the management and feeding.
Okay, okay. So actually, you guys, you sell this stuff.
We sell and we give also free for this small scale farmers.
Oh, because this is a government.
Yeah, government entity.
Ay ga gidel mo mesero gut pander elang ay ga angarngi ay gel maklot talapia el langa lo ara al sel emer goeng ngom el sel 21 days en el et solang et malo tura de plastic bag ay mna se sel blind mo mesel el petok ngal sel plastic bag ngal sel sel 24 hours el the climatized the rulin mo le tial ran mangartianga am gal gol tum tungun mo sentel gem magal tum tungun mo mo atir temperature say material farmers sel bel ola gel la ye gidel ngal gel ay gat talapia et the mal mong directly ngal sel gel plastic bag el mo tro tura gel pandertir ma temperature sel el pandertir mo sel sel bag ad wa sigid mo 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 atir et the slowly release ay talapia ay gel talapia ngal sel bag thousands of them en atel mo do urtir to sel gel small scale farmers trigel mgegres sira agablemente administered free
ngapel mengada do urtir et mo meska ha design ra kel tanga matlet telel ado ochis baral mrngi edo magai kal arm e sola et mo la sela 6 months na mos pemlo tra okay te doral mo chega kel bevirra a facility til ngarse
we also install a hapa here or like inverted mosquito net for stocking this breeder also. Luckily, you arrive without
the mosquito. They lay eggs in there.
No,
too?
No. Mosquito net.
No,
converted mosquito net. It's hapa.
But what about in Palau? I'm afraid that maybe when we make a pond, and the mosquito go in
we'll
there.
Breed,
no.
No.
Yeah. But the tilapia will eat.
Yeah.
Oh, so tilapia will eat the mosquito, eh?
Yeah. Mosquito. Even after the egg. It's also a protein for tilapia.
I see. Okay, so we don't have to worry about the
mosquito.
So these tanks are for, there's tilapia in here?
Tilapia is inside, yeah.
Oh.
Here, tilapia.
Okay. And do you feed?
We feed them.
Oh.
Because they have no access to natural food.
Oh.
That's why the color of this is greenish. Those are uneaten feeds and their excreta produces also plankton.
Now for the tilapia, if they, let's say that I've got a big pond like that. And
not
I put,
so big.
Do I have to feed only. Them?
If yeah,
I
you feed them also there.
Oh yeah? The but there's a natural food like mosquito. Yeah.
You need to fertilize the pond with chicken manure. No, it serves only as fertilizer for the water. To produce microscopic plants and animals for them to eat. That is what we call plankton, microscopic plants and animals. For,
can we buy feed from
Yeah, commercial feeds.
Yeah, we have commercial feeds here. And also you can also
make your own.
So if I go to a chicken farm and just collect the chicken manure and throw them inside, okay?
No.
It will grow slowly only. But if you do have this formulated diet from your nearby places there.
No more okay. That one. Like for milk fish.
You will import?
Yeah, we import from PI. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so.
You know, pig feed and milk fish feed and also tilapia, we get it from here.
All right.
No problem, okay. So that business will thrive.
Yeah.
Okay, that's it.
But you can do your own feed formulation.
As long as they send
the they have also the technology.
We have the duck with
you. Oh, so you have to make the recipe, you know?
Yeah,
Sandy
will take charge.
This guy is in charge of that.
His nutrition.
Yeah.
I hear mestizos.
Okay.
Okay. He's the one.
So when I go back, I'm scientist for sure.
Yeah.
Oh, this is from the funding came from US, yeah. No?
No.
For
no,
this?
For this?
This is a local government,
yes.
This funding of this.
From the park.
National.
From the
national park.
Yeah, that's what
this is. The president only graced the opening.
The unveiling
of this laboratory.
Remember Mr. Tayamin, he mentioned to you that we have tagged around 1,000 of fish, and then we stock them communally just to see the best performing individual. And then Mila now will show you how we do it.
Okay.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Okay. I will show you how to tag the fish using the external tag. First, this is the external tag or the fingerling fly tag. See, it has a family number and the individual number. So to keep track the individual performance of the fingerlings up to a grow-out stage. So we will anesthetize the fish before we tag it using the MS-222 or the triclane methane sulfonate.
Is it like anesthesia?
So this is the fingerling and we will insert the tag between the 6th and the 7th dorsal spine. So this is the dorsal spine of the fingerling, between the 6th and the 7th dorsal spine. 2, 4, 6, or 7. So here, okay. Above the lateral line. So this is the lateral line. So we don't have to hit the lateral line so that there will be no abnormality. Okay. Through and through. This is the hypoallergenic vinyl thread. Okay, the plastic disc. We will put plastic disc to prevent the knot from contacting into the flesh. So we will put some allowance for the fish because it will, after 4 months, the fish will more thicker. Okay. So this is our finished product in ponds communally to assess the performance of the fish. And once a month, we will sample the fish and read the tag number and get the growth of growth and the length of the fish. That is our external tag. And we also have the internal tag or the permanent identification ID of the tilapia. After we evaluate the fish and we rank them, so we will select the best individual, and we will replace the Floyd tag with microchip or the passive. Is our fish.
Size.
And it's the
so
size
you're
again.
The bigger fish.
Yes, yes.
The selected fish.
Once yeah. This one grow, that big, they will change it too.
Yeah, but we will not lose. This is our tag reader to read the tag microchip. Okay, so the tag number that we were going to insert to our fish is 4060. To identify.
For example, you put it on that fish there, you can take that machine and read the number of that fish.
With the reader.
Once you inject that into the fish. Yeah. Okay, I see.
Later they will show you how to read it.
I see.
Inside.
Inside the fish.
Yes.
Okay. So that tag will be permanently in that fish. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So the fish now is half asleep?
Yep.
You will lift the scales and insert it slowly. Okay. And let's try to read.
Read the tag.
Read the tag. So it's in there.
Same number.
Okay, same number.
Yes.
Yeah. So we stay there for inahuli mo siya, hindi mo siya pwede kainin.
Yes, I have to return the tag. Please return the tag. Because it's costly.
When you get the tag,
try mo muna, try yung lead.
Pag nakuha mo yung tag, pwede mo ipalit dito.
So how many months is this big one here? How many months is that?
This
one here. 3 months. And then another 3 months is probably going to be much longer than that.
Yes.
Yes. Longer and bigger. But usually they put the tag on a fish that will make the male, that will make it a breeder, right?
Yes, only the selected,
only selected fish.
Only the selected.
They don't put tags
on any one of them.
Yeah, because it's expensive. Yeah.
Oh, I see, I see. So this one here, you later on you get identified by reading the number
breeder.
And
yes,
good
sir.
Reader.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
And so and you take it and put it in the pond over there for a breeder, and then 21 days you go and pick up the fingerlings.
Yes, and by having this tag, you can trace the lineage, and you can avoid the inbreeding.
I see.
Yeah, just like in humans, relative should not be married or like that.
Mate.
Yeah, that
mate. Because if you do, they're gonna be like abnormal.
Yeah.
They look ugly.
Same with the fish.
Same with the fish. Eh?
Yeah.
So where are you putting the fish at?
Different tanks, breeder tanks.
Yes, and then those breeders are shipped or are sent to different regions of the country. Because this is the National Broodstock Center for Tilapia.
So the tag doesn't bother this size fish in its swimming.
Like what we have there in 1987, and there is a study conducted to evaluate if there is difference in tag fish and untag fish, and the result was there is no significant
difference.
This 12 years, human 12 years?
It's like a
grandparent. You better stay.
What is the lifespan of a breeder like that?
We're still looking at the
24 human years or fish years?
Human.
I see.
Because you have some old fish there, they are stupid. Like old people, they also
get crooked. This one is crooked already.
So this one is old man or old lady?
Man.
This is male?
Whether it's crocodile, it's
the papilla of the tilapia. So if it's male, it has two openings, one the anus and the other the urogenital papilla.
That's a male. I see.
If it's female, it has a slit here. So three openings for the female.
Three openings,
female,
yeah.
It says slice like that. Yeah. Same with the human.
So this is an old man, eh?
Yeah. The O.M.
Still kicking. Can you read?
Yeah, they're going to read the tag number.
That's a male.
Okay. So this is the tag number of our old fish.
That's his number.
Number.
Just like a prisoner.
Yeah.
12 years?
Same.
Probably
10. Because we evaluate first the performance of that fish before we tag. So 10 years.
10 years.
Yeah. Yeah. That's possible. Yeah, the last hour of memory first day. Ya ging at the facility the lack of internal recycle talapial dengan member boy lo ataka sel e mal ora gel tang ke member boy mo mo man ora gel pan den arule e solang den bru la ge gitu ngal gel talapia etian building ngat dia la nga ora vision center etian a serate mela president arroyo dem ne unveil ra opening at the building ya ga gitu roku il ngat dia facility at pan da government tra republic of the philippines. So I think our staff and all the employees have been nice to us and taking us around. So I would like to take this opportunity and thank the government of the Philippines and also our ambassador to the Philippines for this opportunity. And now we are able to see the progress of tilapia aquaculture. And I think the Republic of Palau can benefit from this idea also. That's why I'm here. And as you all see the sign behind me, it says, CFAR and FFDC welcome guests and visitors of the Association of the Republic of Palau. We thank you so much, Republic of the Philippines. I hope we can be friends and continue on helping each other at time like this so we can all, you know, eat the same fish, you know, and then everybody will be happy. Because you know what, we got 5,000 or 6,000 Filipinos in Palau working there, and we would like for them to enjoy the same fish that you have here in the Philippines and also the Palauans. Thank you. So this is the research where you do all the research in this building.
Yes, sir. This is more of like genetic conservation. So say if something happened to the Philippines, you can do the samples that we have. And this was established in 1993 with the help of Dr. Christian Rana University. So this is how we collect the egg. So we strip the female tilapia, and we know the female fish is ready to spawn. Say you strip it, and then the egg will come out together with the ovarian fluid. Then we know that it's ready for fertilization. Then we will tow the cryopreserved milk or some or spermatozoa together with the egg over here, and then after mixing the egg and the cryopreserved milk, we will put it in our incubator. Mm-hmm. Then after 9 to 12 days, we will have the fry. These are the small
tilapia. Very small. Yes. How many millions of those? That's a lot.
No, there are maybe around 300 pieces of fry.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so we can have about 5 to 6 fry per gram weight of fish tilapia. Say you have 100 grams, you can put about 500 to 600.
Storing samples. Yes. This is, you put the sperm in there, mm-hmm. and you can keep it for years
yes,
and years.
Sir, yes, sir.
Okay. Like we do in the humans. Humans
yes,
now they
sir.
Can store their sperm
yes,
for later
generation.
Yeah, generation.
Yes.
I see.
In the science center, we have 3 gene banks. One for tilapia, one for rice, and one for caramel.
So what you do in here, you can do what we call artificial insemination?
Yes, sir. This is what is happening.
Yeah. Okay. So you inject it in there, and then that's the end result
yes,
will be down there.
So it's enough to preserve the sample, yeah, because the temperature is negative 196.
I see.
Degrees. Yes, sir. And the biochemical activity, they stop at negative 150. So it's very safe to use liquid nitrogen. So this is the same thing right inside. Mm-hmm. There will be some straws, and you can see there the number of the fish, picked up number of the
mm-hmm.
fish.
Yeah, so. Oh, boy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It can burn you.
Yes, it's like a frostbite when it's spilled.
So, and those are just sitting right here for years and years and
mm-hmm.
no problem.
Yes, sir.
So this is your cryobank?
Yes, sir. This is the gene bank we have here. And the sample that we preserved in 1995, we use it to in one of our research with together with the World Fish Center in from a project in Malaysia, wherein we estimate the genetic gain or the progress that we are doing with the selection program that we have. So we revived the fish that has been cryopreserved in 1995, last 2005, that is after 10 years. So that's why we were able to estimate the progress that we are having with the selection program.
That's the same stuff that they use at the human sperm bank,
yes,
right?
Yes, sir. Same DWAR, the liquid nitrogen. Mm-hmm. According to scientists, Paul, they can remain viable from 200 to 32,000 years, so in almost infinity, as long as they are immersed in liquid nitrogen and there's this radiation, I mean, keep it away from radiation.
Technology.
Technology.
Yeah. We're able to
revive.
Yeah. In other words, if you get a human sperm and put in there, maybe 50, 100 years later, you can bring it back.
Yes.
If we had this technology, Robert Einstein, could have.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
And we can. He's gone now, but we can.
Yes.
Right away, it's history.
Yes. You can have a surrogate mother like that.
Yeah.
So as you can see, it's just a few guys. They are concrete bundles, which we made as our incubator for tilapia.
Tilapia keep the eggs inside the mouth?
You can see the egg, and then this is the mouth.
Instead, when in the mouth,
fry.
It comes like that?
Yeah, after this time.
In the mouth?
Yes, sir.
How many of them in the mouth?
It depends on the size of the mother.
The
if the fish is big, then you have more than 1,800, like that. Yes, sir. 5 to 6 fry per gram weight of female. So if there's 500 gram fish, then times 5.
Feeding time inside the mouth, just rotating.
Rotating inside the mouth. Just like what you do here in the incubator.
That's what we are trying to simulate.
Oh, you simulate inside the mother's mouth. I see. That's why they're, you got the water in there turning the eggs. I see. Okay.
Then the mother died, or
no, sir.
Maybe so skinny.
After the mother had already released the fry, then she'll be ready again to eat. Then she will recover, then again ready for another spawning. So she can spawn at least once a month.
Small only.
The
breeder size is like this.
Wow. Man, your country is flat. Those are the mountains way out there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is Sierra Madre Mountains.
Mga bag is there.
Yeah. So what did you speak?
father's building.
What's ula?
Freshwater prawn.
In Mindanao region.
Use, eh?
Meron pong buwan niya.
Very good to eat, sir.
We have here a live one.
You have also this species in Palau?
Yeah.
Also virgin? But they don't eat, they don't
We used to catch them when they were kids.
Only for a while.
Nice and cool.